Good morning and welcome to Talk All Week in Ministry. Well, we're here again, but always in another place, another environment, and I praise God just to have the opportunity to come before you to share the word which He has provided to me. And before we get into that, I just want to take a few minutes and just to lean in and just pray. And so even now, Father God, in the name of Jesus, even as you have refreshed me, and you have given me your word, I pray that it falls on good ground. And each person receiving of it really come to understand what you have put on the inside of them. I pray that they not only see what you've given them, but they really understand what partnership with you look like. And as they partner with you, they are able to partner with the body of Christ to truly bring forth the things that you have called for and designed for all of us to walk in. And that's that place of unity, that place of freedom, that place where we truly understand the relationship that we have with one another, but also your wisdom, your knowledge, and your understanding that continue to take us from glory to glory. Holy Spirit, I'm not always the best person to pray, but I always look to you for insight, for understanding, and direction that I may be able to share with your body exactly what's needed at this time. So before I go forward, I look to you. Anything else I should pray, even now, that truth prevails, that light shines in every area that is dark within us, and that your wisdom is exalted, and that we come into a place of relationship where you're truly honored. In Christ Jesus' name, I pray. Amen.
Amen.
Well, this is an easy message because it makes me laugh because it's something that I recognize, you know, that's different about me and different about how I was raised versus other people are raised. And so I tell you guys a simple story, and hopefully when I share the story out, you guys really get and understand what the Holy Spirit is directing us. We'll be in Mark 8, and I guess this is the first time I see Mark 8 from a different perspective, and I am floored by what he shared with me because it helps me to understand where I'm going. And so I will give you guys insight. When I first got married, you know, I moved into the house with my mother-in-law, and it was kind of different for me. And the main reason why it was different because she's Filipino, and you know, I'm from the African descent. And so I noticed, like, every single time she had house guests coming in, I don't care who it is, she literally would go out of her way to find something in the cabinet to feed. She just immediately became that person to whereby she became a servant and just began to provide food. And so moving into my own place and then entertaining my new family, you know, I remember them coming into my house and I'm like, yeah, I can get no food. I'm not feeding you guys because that wasn't what I was raised with. You know, we didn't go out of our way. We didn't do anything. You know, if somebody came to your house, you entertained them. If you offered them water, it was a miracle, okay? If you offered them something to drink, it's just something that sometimes never really happened. And that's the way I was raised. But then, as I began to look at the relationship, I began to look at, how do I adapt what she has? How do I bring people into my space and make them feel at home? What do? How do I offer something that's going to nourish? And then in my mind, I said, well, when I go shopping, find out what they like and make sure I have it available and to ensure that there's something always there for somebody. And so I began to take on some of the things that I readily see my mother-in-law do, and it really began to make me feel a little bit more comfortable when it came to hospitality, because that's something that I didn't realize that was on the inside of me. From my mother-in-law, and now I do today. You know, a lot of times we look at things and we're thinking that, hey, we don't have something within ourselves to do, but even as we're shown things, we're supposed to pick up and then practice what we're shown, and then as we practice it, 90% of the time, you do it even better than what the first person presented to you, because you now understand what's being said. Are asked of you. And so as I began to look at Mark 8, I was like, whoa, Lord, this is something I know about, okay? But he said, but I want you to take a deeper look into this message. So, Jamila, I'm going to rely on you.
Starting at verse 1?
Yes.
Mark 8, verse 1. In those days, the multitude being very great and having nothing to eat, Jesus called his disciples unto him and said unto them, I have compassion on the multitude, because they have now been with me 3 days and have nothing to eat. And if I send them away fasting to their own houses, they will faint by the way, for divers of them came from afar. And his disciples answered him, from whence can a man satisfy these men with bread here in the wilderness?
Let me stop there, because that's what he literally said. We're all in this place. There's wilderness, there's drought. And we're in this place because we're looking within ourselves, and we all see that there's some form of a lack. But the Holy Spirit was saying to me, as I was looking at this particular scripture, he was literally looking to me for me to understand something so simple. There's no lack within you.
Amen.
He said, there's nothing that you don't possess that I have not given you. He was literally making sure that I understood for the journey thereof, I fully equipped you. You have everything you need. And I don't know if any of you guys remember Dora the Explorer.
Sure do.
She had this backpack that she had everything that she needed within it. Better yet, you guys know, you know, what was that movie that The Rock was in and Kevin Hart was in?
Jumanji.
Even in that, he had everything that was needed for his journey, right? So no matter what it was, he became an expert at whatever it was that he was tasked to do. And every single one of them, if you begin to look at it, they were prepared for their journey. Each and every one of them had an issue that they were challenged by. But even with the issue they were challenged by, they still were well equipped. And the Lord was showing me these two particular situations, and he's like, hey, I want you to look at this one, and I want you to look at that. No matter what it is, I put a compass on the inside of you, and as you move forward, what I have put on the inside of you shall rise up when it's necessary. And then so I begin to look at him and say, wait a minute, Lord. You're having me to have a conversation with your body regarding this. That we're fully equipped and that we have everything that we need. I can't see that because over here we're lacking, over there we're lacking. I can't get anybody to move here or move there. He said to me, every Sunday, you sit before me for a word. And every Sunday, what do you say? I don't have nothing more. And he said, do do not provide something for the body?
Amen.
He said, but walk them through what you do. I come in and I get up every morning and I'm stressing because I want it ahead of time. I want it days before. I want to be able to eat on it before I offer it to somebody else. So I want to see it in and out. I want to be able to go back and say, oh, I got this awesome word that is so great, that is so tasty. You guys all need to hear it. And I want to serve it up before the day. And in past time, he has done that to where he's given it to me way ahead of time. And I've been excited. But then when he gives it to me way ahead of time, when I sit in front of the people, I'm sharing something completely different. And I'm like, wait a minute, Lord, that's not what you gave me. You're supposed to go this direction, and now you're taking me that direction, or you're going this direction, and now you're doing something different. And he literally said to me, when I give it to you, I'm not only teaching you, but I'm teaching them. And so it's better that you get it when it's fresh, as well as they get it. But then he took me a little bit further. He said, I gave you the word to share with my people. And he said, and for all the ones that are with you, I gave each one of them administrative gifts. And he said, but they're looking as if I didn't give them something. He said, every single one of them have what it takes and what it needs to carry forth this body.
Amen.
Into what I'm calling you to become.
Yes.
He said, but many of them been fasting, seeking the things in which I've already given them. And they're falling short along the way. And then I said, okay, Lord, why are they falling short and they feel like they're lacking? He said, because they're so busy looking outside instead of looking within and begin to cultivate the things that I put on the inside of them in order to become everything that they need to become. He said, and even to some situations, they're expecting others to do what I've given them to do. And I said, wow. He said, you have one task to share the word, to pray for the people. Mm. And the most important thing is to trust me. He said, each one of them have a few things I've given them. As he began to speak to the disciples, he said in the next scripture, what did the disciples say? Can you read the next scripture? Verse.
Yeah, verse 4 of Mark 8 says, and his disciples answered him, from whence can a man satisfy these men?
Stop there. From whence can a man satisfy these men? When you recognize he's not the provider, that his Lord is providing for them. Because we're still looking within. And then the things that we're looking within, we see it's deficient.
True.
And God is literally saying, look to me. He said, because I know exactly what I put on the inside of you in order for you to become what is needed for those to come. But a lot of times when God gets us to see our giftings, we discredit them. And the main reason why we discredit what God's given us is because it doesn't look like somebody else. Doesn't look like somebody else. He makes me laugh. If you were in a room and everybody showed up with the same garment you have on today, you would think something wrong.
Truly.
Like, where'd you go? Where'd you shop at? Girl, why you been in my office? He said, we are even sometimes amazed when somebody wears the same colors.
True.
Yeah.
And he said, it makes you question and you look at your closet to say, the next time, I ain't wearing that that person may wear. He's literally trying to get us to understand that each one of us is uniquely different. We have our own shoes to walk in, and we need to trust the shoes that we have.
Yes.
And that the shoes that we have, he's prepared your shoes with everything that needed. Wow. He shows me like someone with some tennis shoes, but no shoestrings. Isn't it hard to walk without the shoestrings? He shows me somebody with tennis shoes and they're not properly laced. Isn't it sometimes difficult to go without it properly laced? And then he shows me somebody with tennis shoes on with no socks on. You only can wear a feet without socks for a little while because after a while your feet sweat. And it still causes problems. Because if you take them off, then you find yourself scared to really take them off because people may smell the perspiration that comes forth as a result of your shoes. But he said, nevertheless, whether you prepare or not prepare, I still put it in you. He told me to go back to the shoes. He said, reason why we're still in the place, he said, because some of you guys keep trying on other people's shoes. You're trying to fit into what somebody else does. Or you're afraid that if you look different, you're not going to be accepted in the place of what I'm calling you into. He said, hear what the disciples said. Can we read that scripture again?
Mark 8, verse 4. And his disciples answered him, from whence can a man satisfy these men with bread here in the wilderness?
So when can a man satisfy men? How do you satisfy men? Better yet, how do you satisfy men when you're lacking? Because that's what they're literally saying. We ain't got nothing to offer. We're lucky. So how do I satisfy somebody when I don't have nothing? He said, go back to what you said in the beginning. Every Sunday, I'm stressing because I have nothing to offer. But I come into a place where I hear everybody around me worshiping. And in that place of worship, I surrender my fear. And in that place where I'm surrendering my fear, God then brings forth whatever I'm lacking to give to those in need. So in that place where I surrender is when he begins to show me what is needed for this time, this day, this hour. And so it's through others' worship. I remember today as they were singing one of the songs I love that Jamila wrote, that song just automatically takes me into the heavens. And in that place where I began to worship, God literally said, see what I'm showing you. But then I had to stop and truly see that every Sunday is in that place of worship is where I find him. In that place where I just literally lay down all my fears, everything that's speaking to me. Hopefully you guys get it. Everything that's speaking to me. And I want to make sure that you understand, I have loud voices like, you know we ain't got nothing. You know, what you're saying is not going to come across right. All of these things that are speaking to me are surrendering. And in that place, there's calmness, there's peace. And then I hear him saying to me in that quiet place, look at this. Look what I'm trying to show you. And as I begin to look at it, it always speaks to me. And what I walk away with, I'm not lacking. I do have something to offer in this desolate place. And those around me shall not perish.
Amen.
As a result of my surrender to you. And it's not only those around me shall not perish, I won't. And so, as he began to show me this scripture, there's another thing that the disciple says. Let's go to the next verse and read.
Now, verse 5, Mark 8. And he asked them, how many loaves have ye? And they said, 7. And he commanded the people to sit down on the ground, and he took the 7 loaves and gave thanks, and brake, and gave to his disciples to set before them. And they did set them before the people.
And so they were able to see what they had. And what does the number 7 mean?
Completion, perfection.
Get it? So in that place, God had already perfected them, and they didn't see it. And in this place where we're walking, God has already perfected us, and we don't see it. We're still looking as if we're lacking. We're still looking as if we're in need of something. And God is saying, I've already taught you to come to me, and I am thy provider in this place. Get it? He's already taught you to come to him. He's already taught you how to surrender. He already taught you what to do. But still, we keep showing up in the same place, looking for something that we already possess, and it's him. And he literally says, let go. Because how we think we're supposed to achieve something is not how we achieve in him. How we think we're supposed to move in area is not how we move in him. And then he says to me, every time you come before me on Sunday, you got to get past you. And he said, what I'm asking each one of you is to get past you. He said, through my daughter, her place of surrender is through worship. Where is your place of surrender in Christ? How do you surrender? Where is it that I'm able to speak above what's speaking to you? I recognize sometimes when I'm praying in my bedroom, I can't pray in my room. Because if I pray in my room, I'm going to hear me. And I'm going to fall back to sleep. But I'm going to hear me. And the only way I can pray in my room is I get up, I walk around, I move about. that really directs me in the wrong path. But when I'm in that place of worship, my path is secret with my Lord. Because I know he shows up in my place of surrender. And then whatever I'm lacking, I have. I'm no longer then trying to listen to others and coming up with a word. I remember at one point in time when I'd been in my bedroom, let me turn on the TV and let me take whatever this preacher is actually teaching and hear what the Spirit says as I'm receiving and give that to the people. You know what the Lord did? He shut that down. He said, no, I don't want you to take from others because that's what I gave to them. I want you to surrender because I want the quick way out. And I think half of the reason why we're still in some of the places we're in, because we're taking the quick way. Let me just take this and make this into here. Well, the Lord said, that's why they made canned food. Something quick, fast, and easy. And some of you trying to move with canned food instead of really getting the true nourishment of the food that's necessary. And you're trying to serve people canned food. Let me put a little seasoned salt and put a little bit of extra ingredients in it to make it taste like I cooked it. He said, the funny part about things such as that, he said, you'll serve it to others, but you won't eat it. I notice when I serve things that I won't eat to people with eat, I watch them eat it and say, ooh, you made that? Wow. Okay. Let's take it a little bit further.
Mark 8, verse 7. And they had a few small fishes, and he blessed and commanded to set them also before them. So they did eat and were filled. And they took up of the broken meat that was left 7 baskets. And they that had eaten were about 4,000. And he sent them away. And straightway he entered into a ship with his disciples and came into the parts of Dalmanutha.
Can we go back to 7?
Verse 7. And they had a few small fishes, and he blessed and commanded to set them also before them.
What he was showing me in this particular scripture, it was small fishes. He blessed it. And what the Lord was basically saying to me, in the places where you are lacking, I will multiply.
Amen.
He said, I'll provide in the places that you surrender. And then I said, Lord, why in the places where I surrender? He said, because you'll take the credit if you're still involved in it.
Yes.
You'll turn around and say, look what I've done if you're still involved in it.
Yeah.
He said, in return, you get the glory. He said, but when I know you're all in and you have nothing left of you, he said, you will boast of what I've done for you. You shall share with many what I brought you through. He said, but when your cup is half full and I pour into you, you perceive that you're doing it on your own. He said, I took what they offered me. What did they offer? 7 pieces of bread. as a small fish. He said, do you not see? I took it from them and I brought it into what I needed it to be. He said, so when you offer yourself to me, I take what you offer and I make it even greater. He said, but I can't make something great unless you release it. And he says, and some of you are offering me things, but yet your stand is still holding on to it. You haven't fully released it to me, so I can't cause it to become everything that it needed to be. You guys get that? So it's like, oh Lord, I give you my daughter, and I trust you with my daughter, that she's driving me crazy. But I'm still on the outside, still trying to get her to see what's right. I remember the last conversation I had with my youngest daughter. The Holy Spirit said to me, don't talk to her. And what did I do? I kept talking. He said, don't talk to her because she's not listening. She's trying to force her will on you. And she's trying to get you to come in agreement with what she's believing to be true. Better yet, don't talk to her. And then I said, Lord, I'm trying to go to sleep. She's still talking to me. How do I get her out of my room? He said, pray in the spirit. She's gone. What I said. In that place, I begin to surrender to the Spirit. When you surrender in that place, your will can't stand. And in that place, as she began to see I surrendered and I wasn't trying to lead her, she couldn't stand up and continue to try to convince me her will. It couldn't stand in that place. And so when I began to look at this particular scripture, because I said, Lord, what makes it different this time? Because a lot of times when you have shared with us about what the disciples did, you're literally looking to enhance our view of your provision. He said, but this time I'm trying to enhance you to understand that you already have the provision. But the whole point, you're still looking outwardly and not recognize what I put in you. He says, stop discrediting the things that I put on the inside of you because it doesn't look like it should. He said, but as you trust me, it will become everything that you need it to be. It will not only multiply itself, but it will produce and continue to produce in the areas where you're lacking. He says, I'm not asleep on the inside of you. He says, I'm fully awake and I'm ready to move, but you gotta allow me. And then I said, well, how do we get out of our way? It's in your surrender. You'll find me. He said, again, I bring you back. They offered up what they had. You have to offer up what you have. Lord, I offer you my fears.
Yes.
Lord, I offer you my control.
Yes.
Lord, I offer you my frustration. Did you hear what I'm offering? I'm not offering good things. I'm offering what's in my way. I'm offering me what's holding. Offering him what's holding me back. I'm offering him what causes me to overthink. I'm offering him how I see myself.
Yes.
Because sometimes I see myself with all this stuff, but I know that it's not going to help anybody unless I give it to God. I says, I hear you speaking, Lord. I recognize that you're flowing through me. And I recognize the fish in the lungs that I have cannot grow into what you need it to be unless I surrender. So if we can go back to 8.
Mark 8, verse 8. So they did eat and were filled, and they took up of the broken meat that was left 7 baskets.
I said, Lord, why did they have to see what was left over? Because we went away from the number 7, and we came right back to fulfillment again. And I said, whoa, we went from one place where there were 7, and then we came back to 7 again. But this time, it wasn't 7 loaves of bread. It was 7 baskets overflowing with provision. He said, do you see it? Do you see it? And in that basket, the Lord showed me there were individual pieces compared to one loaf of bread. So, individual pieces. And inside each basket, there was a multitude of pieces that arrived from small, even after everyone had eaten. And I want to make sure that you understand, if you haven't, you've been on the fast 3 days, when you come off that fast, how you eat? Where you're overthinking him. And he said, in that place, give me back what you possess. You guys got that right? Because sometimes I possess things and I think I got it. And God said, no, even what you have, can you give it to me?
Amen.
And even what they had to give it back to him in order for them to see what they could do. Get it? In order for them to see what they can do. Because if you look in the book of Acts, they start performing the same thing, because even after he was gone, the Holy Spirit resided in him and he began to move to them and they followed. And so if there was an endless flow in the book of Acts, then there's an endless flow still going forward for us. There wasn't a time limit on his provision. Better yet, he said, there's no limitations unless you put them on. Get it? Lord, I'm going to restrict you here. I'm going to restrict you over here. I'm going to restrict you over there. And how do we restrict them? With our unbelief. Wow. I know I got restrictions. But even in that place, let's pull back. Let's recognize what we have on the inside of us and prevail. And 9 says,
Mark 8, verse 9, and they that had eaten were about 4,000, and he sent them away. And straightway he entered into a ship with his disciples and came into the parts of Dalmanutha. And the Pharisees came forth and began to question with him, seeking of him a sign from heaven, tempting him. And he sighed deeply in his spirit and said, why doth this generation seek after a sign? Verily I say unto you, there shall no sign be given unto this generation. And he left them, and entering into the ship,
let me stop there, because then you say, wait a minute, the disciples are fed, and now he's talking about signs. Isn't that what we want? When we can't produce, isn't that what we said? Show me, Lord, show me, Lord. And the Lord said, believe, believe. But we still say, show me, Lord. I need to know that you're in this place that I'm in. And you know what he said? You're here, I'm here. Get it? So why are we looking for a sign? You're here, I'm here. He didn't make it difficult for me. He said, you're here, I'm here. And then I said, okay, Lord, then why are you not moving? And then he said, get out of my way.
Ooh.
He said, get from in front of me. Because you're coming from great provision. Then all of a sudden these other people come in and they're coming along the path where he's just performed this great signs and wonders and everybody's fed. And he's in this other place now and the disciples are with him. You will probably think the disciples should have said, wait a minute, we just seen a great miracle. We just seen him feed people in this particular place. But instead, no one spoke up. And then I was asking God, okay, so they're with you and no one spoke up. He said, but is it not the way you do things? He said, I provide, and you don't speak up. Mm-hmm. He says, I moved in great areas of your life. You don't tell no one. You're not readily standing. Mm-hmm. simple. All I can say is, Lord, I repent. Let's go a little bit further.
Mark 8, verse 13. And he left them, and entering into the ship again, departed to the other side. Now the disciples had forgotten to take bread, neither had they in the ship with them more than one loaf. And he charged them, saying, take heed, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the leaven of Herod. And they reasoned among themselves, saying, it is because we have no bread. And when Jesus knew it, he said unto them, why reason ye because ye have no bread? Perceive ye not yet, neither understand? Have ye your heart yet hardened? Having eyes, see ye not, and having ears, hear ye not, and do ye not remember? When I break the five loaves among 5,000, how many baskets full of fragments took ye up? They say unto him, 12. And when the seven among 4,000, how many baskets full of fragments took ye up? And they said, 7. And he said unto them, how is it that ye do not understand? And he cometh to Bethsaida.
Wait a minute. That was something he said to us, right? Didn't you guys get that? Go back and read that again.
Starting at verse 13. And he left them, and entering into the ship again, departed to the other side. Now the disciples had forgotten to take bread, neither had they.
Wait a minute. So the disciples have forgotten to take bread. Mm-hmm. Isn't that us? We forget to take in the bread of life. And so we're in this particular place where we're looking like we're standing on our own, thinking God is not with us, and we forget to take in the bread of life, him being the bread of life. Better yet, I'll say it in the simplest way he said it to me. He said, you forget who I am to you. Even after experiencing me and handling me, you forget who I am to you. He said, therefore, you're doing the same thing that the disciples just did. You got me out of that womb, Lord. Wow, great. And then the next task comes, and you're forgetting what? It's like every Sunday, I forget. I come right back and say, oh my God, I don't know the message. I don't know what to do. And I'm stressing and freaking out. It's like I have a pattern of the same bad behavior. I forget. Over and over, I forget. Not only is it I forget Friday, I do the same thing, and I still forget. I constantly forget. I don't know why I forget. But he does the same thing for me every single Friday and Sunday. But in that place, I still operate in that place to whereby I'm freaking out and I'm lucky. Maybe I need to deal with what's in me. And to deal with what's in me, I have to go back to the place where I constantly think that there's no provision. Wow, that sounds like what I grew up with. The funny part about it is, I wasn't the provider of the house. That was my mom that was the provider of the house. So I'm taking on something that's hers and now letting it master me. So today I offer it back up to the Lord because he said he wants the stuff. And then I trust him because he's always provided the word. Hopefully you guys get it. He's always providing. It doesn't look like what I want it to look like. Give it to me now. Let me have it. So I can boast of it now and forget it when the day comes to teach.
Wow.
Because that's what I do. But even now, let me surrender how I see this. Surrender how you see this. went back and looking at that again. What was the next part of that?
Mark 8, verse 15. And he charged them, saying, take heed, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the leaven of Herod. And they reasoned among themselves, saying, it is because we have no bread. And when Jesus knew it, he said unto them, why reason ye, because ye have no bread? Perceive ye not, neither understand? Have ye your heart yet hardened? Having eyes?
He said, perceive ye, have ye not understand? So evidently, if we're in this place that we're thinking that God is not for us, we don't understand.
Yeah.
How do you perceive this? What are you looking at? What's telling you that God is not the provider?
Mm.
And in that place where you don't understand, you need to get understanding.
Mm-hmm.
But to understand is to understand what is causing you to believe as such.
Yeah.
In my situation, I have taken on how my mother took care of me, and in that place, I'm allowing her way of seeing it, even when I understood what was going on with her.
Yeah.
But I'm still allowing that to govern me.
Yeah.
But I'm not perceiving God brought me out of that, because even in that place where she wasn't operating accordingly, I cried out and asked God for help that I may not operate that way. So I must deal with the thought pattern that's coming forward and begin to submit that unto Christ. Wow. Let's go back, and there was something else that was in there, because he said, perceive ye. Then what other part he said, but there was four things that he said in there that he really wants us to hear.
Verse 17, why reason ye because ye have no bread?
So number one, stop reasoning. What's the second one?
Perceive ye not?
Perceive, have a better understanding of what he's doing.
Neither understand?
Okay, that one goes the same.
Have ye your heart yet hardened?
Deal with your heart issues. You guys know why our hearts are. Everybody can see it. Everybody can see something happened that caused us to believe something different.
Yes.
You know, if Santa Claus was real, I would probably still believe in him.
Yeah.
But what happened was I found out that they wasn't telling the truth. And when I found out they wasn't telling the truth, it automatically changed how I see him.
Yes.
And I recognized that it wasn't real.
Right.
But my Lord is not like that.
Amen.
I can clearly see him. And not only is it that I can see him, but I see what he is calling for. And how do I see it? By what he's showing me and all the things that I have done. Okay, so sounds like it's a heart issue with us, right?
Truly, yes.
It's a heart issue, and really, it's not only a heart issue, it has to do with whatever we went through that shaped us in a negative way. Let's go a little bit further.
Mark 8, verse 18. Having eyes, see ye not, and having ears, hear ye not.
So he's literally saying, you have eyes and ears. But he's not speaking of eyes and ears in the natural. He's saying you have spiritual wisdom and you have spiritual insight. Can you not see? Do you not understand?
like, have me not experienced what I just did.
Exactly.
Weren't you there?
Yeah, exactly. Weren't you there?
And that's what he's literally telling the disciples. Weren't you there when I fed this group? Wasn't you there when I fed that group? Wasn't you there when I did this? And it's just like something he did for you. Weren't you there when I turned around and caused favor to come forward on your job when there was no favor? Weren't you there when I offered grace when you wasn't able to get to work on time? Weren't you there? Weren't you there when I shut the mouth of the people that were speaking against you? Wasn't you there? He said, wasn't you there when you were lacking and I provided? It's like, Charlene, when you ask for a better job, to be able to speak to the people and be able to really become that place and to influence others, weren't you there? When I did it? He said, will you be there when I do the next thing for you? So will you guys be there when he does the next thing for you? Or you will be present and not know that I moved. Well, because I think a lot of times we're present and we don't even know God's moving for us. Hmm. Oh, that was God. Wow, I didn't know that was you, Lord. Wow. You get it 2 years later, it's like, oh my God, you were in my life. You seen me. You heard me. Oh my God, you were changing things for me. I didn't even know you were there. Haven't you guys had that conversation with him? Like, oh my God, you were there when I was 6 years old. Oh, you were there when that car came close to destroying me. Oh my God, you were there when I fell off a swing and you picked me up. Oh my God, you were there. He said it's important that you're present in your own life.
Amen. Mark 8, still verse 18. And do ye not remember when I break the 5 loaves among 5,000, how many baskets full of fragments took ye up? They say unto him, 12.
Wait a minute. In that, he's saying, even in the midst of what I was doing from you, I allowed you to participate and handle it as well. So you wasn't at one looking in, being an spectator. You were actually involved. So what the Lord is basically saying to us, in the midst of the things that I've been walking you through, you've been involved. You know that I've been there. He said, but yet you're still in the place of questioning me. Yet you're still in that place where you're doubting me. He said, yet you still think I'm not for you.
Yeah.
He said, I asked a question of you. Who is for you if I'm not?
Mm.
Oh, that really makes you stand like, who's for? I don't know.
That's going up.
Mark 8, verse 20. And when the 7 among 4,000, how many baskets full of fragments took ye up? And they said, 7. And he said unto them, how is it that ye do not understand?
He said, how is it that you don't understand? He says, I need you to know that this walk is not just something you're walking. He said, but I'm with you. He says, I'm with you every step of the way. He said, when you choose to rest, he says, I'm there to pick you up and carry you forward. He said, even in your injury, I'm still there, moving you forward. He said, never leaving you in the same place, but always pushing you forward. know how that kid kicks and screams, and you still pushing that person forward, that person that's kicking the heck out of God, but he's still pushing them forward. And that's in that place some of us go kicking and screaming, but he still don't mind you kicking him, but he keeps going. Wow, that's been me. Thanks, Billy.
Mark 8, verse 22. And he cometh to Bethsaida, and they bring a blind man unto him, and besought him to touch him. And he took the blind man by the hand, and led him out of the town. And when he had spit on his eyes, and put his hands upon him, he asked him if he saw aught. And he looked up and said, I see men as trees walking. After that, he put his hands again upon his eyes, and made him look up, and he was restored, and saw every man clearly. And he sent him away to his house, saying, neither go into the town, nor tell it to any in the town.
Wow. He said, do you see the blind man? And then I said, Lord, I don't really see him. He said, why is it that you're not seeing what I'm showing you with this blind man? He says, I'm changing his vision to bring him into true focus of what I'm calling for. I'm bringing you into true focus of what I'm calling for. Do you not see why this is written? This is to cause you to really, truly see that I am focusing you back on me. Blind man, he said, he doesn't see men clearly. Did you get it? He said, I can't see them. They look like trees. And God caused his focus to come into clear view so that he could see everything. And so a lot of times we're saying, Lord, what you're bringing forth, it doesn't look like it. It looks like something else. Do you get it? We may not call it a tree, but we call it something else. And God says, I'm bringing you into true focus that you can clearly see that I'm with you. Well, that job doesn't look right. It looks like somebody else gonna get it. And God says, no, I'm bringing you into full focus of the provision I have for you. So whether the one you're looking at, you may not have a clear insight to it, I'm gonna cause you to have a clear insight, and I'm gonna bring something that's beyond what you see. And so he kept changing his vision. He kept bringing it into the place where he had clarity of what he was looking at. Say it out loud.
I just said that reminds me when you go get your eyes checked and they cut, you know, they say one or two so that they can get you into the clear vision when you're sitting behind whatever that machine is called. And they dial your vision into 20/20 so that you can see clearly.
And that's what God does. He dials our spiritual vision into that 20/20 perspective. Okay. Causing you to see according to his will and not according to what you see so you don't faint along the way. I love how he took you back to the first part of that scripture so you don't faint along the way. Keep going.
Mark 8, verse 27. And Jesus went out and his disciples into the towns of Caesarea Philippi. And by the way, he asked his disciples, saying unto them, whom do men say that I am? And they answered, John the Baptist, but some say Elias, and others, one of the prophets. And he said unto them, but whom say ye that I am?
Let me stop. Because he's coming back and he's asking us a question. He said, based on what you've seen me do thus far and all the miracles and things that you have seen, who do you say I am? Better yet, what is others saying about me first?
Wow.
he trying to get us to see in that question?
You don't know what he's trying to get you to see?
Not
he's not. Your provider. What have you come to conclude? That not only he's your provider, that everything that you possess is already on the inside of you. Every single thing that you've been trying to navigate through, you already have the wisdom. Because that's what he started off with in the beginning. He's trying to get you to see that you have it. And even where you don't have it in your surrender, I'll provide. He said, better yet, I'm trying to get you to see, to get out of that place where you're in self-reliance and being in a place where you're relying on me. Remember, they kept looking at, oh, what we didn't have. Oh, well, maybe we didn't collect enough offering to get this bread. Oh, maybe we didn't do this to do that. Oh, maybe we didn't do this or whatever. They didn't see it. Even when the people came up to them and they began to test Jesus and asked him, you know, in regards to what do you see here or what do you see there, they still didn't get it. They should have all been able to come forward and say, hey, wait a minute, we seen this, we seen that, we seen this, we seen that, we seen this. We should be able by now to say all these things as well, but we don't. We can't say it now. And so if something was wrong with them and they had been with him so long and they still couldn't see it, what's in the way of us seeing the things that God is calling for us to see? What's in your way? But he says what's in our way based on scripture. Go back to the part that they test him. Jamila, if you can go back to the part where they're testing him. What's he saying? What word did he use?
Mark 8, verse 11. And the Pharisees came forth and began to question him, seeking of him a sign from heaven, tempting him.
But what did he say about that?
And he sighed deeply in his spirit and said, why doth this generation seek after a sign? Verily I say unto you, there shall no sign be given unto this generation.
And then he said, be aware of the what?
Leaven. Of the Pharisees and of the leaven of Herod.
So what's the leaven of Pharisees, you guys? What's the leaven of the Pharisees? What is a Pharisee? What was their truly thing they operated in?
Unbelief.
Exactly. So he's literally trying to get you to see, where is it that you keep operating in the place where you don't believe? And so when you say leaven, unleavened bread, let's look at unleavened bread. Can we break down what unleavened bread looks like?
It's a cracker.
Okay. And when it's leavened, what does it do?
Rise.
So what is it really saying to you? That bread that you're offering has risen. Mm. It's puffed up, proud, and it cannot see. So we got to reduce that bread down.
Yeah.
Do you guys get it?
Mm-hmm.
Because what he's literally saying to us, that we take the bread and we add to it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Because we lack understanding of it. And then it becomes something that we can't even eat. it right. They knew it, but they didn't follow it. And even when they're looking for a sign, they really weren't well the sign. They wouldn't even understand and recognize the sign that was before them. And some of us won't even recognize if he gave us a sign. So you're asking for something that you really don't want. Oh my God. Isn't that what we're doing in so many areas of our life? We're asking for stuff that we really don't want. Open your eyes, clearly see it. Remember, he's touched the blind man's eyes in order for him to clearly see. We have to be able to tap into ourselves to really, truly see. He doesn't serve up a message that you're supposed to be in that place that I don't get it. You're supposed to be able to get it.
Amen.
And how you get it is on the inside of each one of us, we get different revelation based on our experience of him. And as he's popping things forward on the inside of you, he's showing you what you do.
Yeah.
And in that place, you've got to come to the end of yourself and say, I can't do that no more. Because you get one of them, whoa. It's like even seeing through the lenses where you're at the optometrist and you're looking through these lenses and they're trying to set your vision clear based on what you said. And a lot of times you got to tell them to go back to that one. Let me see that one again. And you go back 2, 1, 1, 2. No. Go back again, okay? And then you say, this is clear. And God is trying to get us to go back to some of these places and get a clear perspective of what we're looking at in order to move forward. You can't see through your own lenses. You got to see through his lenses. And so go back to your 1, 2, 1, 2. No, that's not clear. This is clear. This is right. This is not right. In order to come into the things he's calling for. He said your view has now been reset.
Amen.
Stand in truth. And he says, and stop adding to the word. Remember, they added to the word. They took away from the word. And that's what you don't want to do. You don't want to add, nor do you want to take away. And if you lack understanding, sit for him before him, and he'll open up whatever you're looking at so that you have clear insight to what you're walking through. You know, I was standing outside with the gentleman earlier, and somebody basically said, whoa, about this race. And the Holy Spirit began to show me the race, because the person was saying something about the race in a fashion that they didn't understand it. But the Holy Spirit began to show me the race and that we had to run our race. He said, but what you don't know in that race, I said, a water man every step of the way. And as you run, there's living water ready and waiting on you every step you take.
Mm-hmm.
He said, it's about you drinking along the way.
Amen.
Taking it and drinking. He said, to be fully nourished as you're running. And then he showed me potholes, he showed me hills, he showed me mountains, he showed me valleys, he showed me green places to where you can come and rest. You know, there's park benches along the way that you can sit or whatever. And he said, all of that's available.
Amen.
He said, but it's necessary that you keep moving forward. So he's saying, you can come and sit, you can sit there, you can do this, you can decide this hill, or whatever the case, but it's still necessary that you move forward. And then wrapping this word up, because it's really talking about him, let's go ahead and read the last part.
Mark 8, verse 31. Actually, verse 29.
Yes.
And he said unto them, but whom say ye that I am? And Peter answered and said unto him, Thou art the Christ. And he charged them that they should tell no man of him.
And what he was literally saying, I need you to understand who I am. And why did he say that you tell no man? Because I always said, wasn't that their job to tell them? He wants each man to find out for themselves.
Mm-hmm.
You're just sharing your testimony. They will find him. And it wasn't the time for them to fully reveal who he is. Because he had to complete his journey.
Yes.
And there's times in our life that God moves us forward. We're not really truly sharing who the source is, but yet we know.
Mm-hmm.
But when the journey is complete, everybody will know.
Mm-hmm.
Not only who you serve, but who your Lord is. Say to them that I have each one of them. He says, say to them, you're not alone in this walk. But tell them that I hear them. He says, not only have I not changed your view today, but I've drawn you even closer to me through this word.
Amen.
He says, even in that place where you have chosen surrender, I have met you, and I shall continue to meet you. All I'm asking is that you trust me, and that in the places where you surrender your all to me, you rest in me. And he says, and I shall provide, and I shall pour into you all that I desire. He said, hear me, understand the words in which I have spoken to you today. He said, let me have your heart, and let me deal with the things that have dealt with you. All I'm asking is that you surrender them today. And so if this word has met you in any area, it's just simply calling out to your Lord where you're at. And literally saying, Lord, I release it all to you. That your will may go forward. And that your righteousness may prevail on the inside of me. Causing me to see clearly into the things that you have called for. Lord, I'm no longer trying to expand things, but I'm really in that place where I'm literally laying down myself that you may prevail. Increase in me. He said one more time, increase in me. In that place where you have allowed him to increase in you, rededicate your life back by simply saying, Lord, I surrender my control over to you, that you may have your will in my life. And that you may begin to move through me. Lord, I believe in you. My Savior, my Lord, my God. Have your way. your will, your plans, and all the things that you desire for me, that may go forward, and I may complete the things you have for me. This day, forever. If you said that prayer, know that God has heard you. But for that new believer, taking it one step forward further, Lord, I invite you into my life. Be my Lord, be my Savior, be my God. Lord, I know that you have set a compass on the inside. And I feel that I've lost my way. Redirect me in your paths of righteousness for your name's sake. This I ask of you this day. In Jesus' name I pray. And if you've said that, tell someone. Because it's so important that others know that you have accepted Christ. And trust him.